think I live. I am tired. I am weak. I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, precious Lord, my guiding light, take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home.
You turn to Isaiah chapter 64, verse 8. I got the call from Janet, or text from Janet, and she asked me last Tuesday, Doug, where are you? And I knew time was getting close. I'd seen her go down fast. And when Janet said, Doug, where are you? All morning long, I couldn't motivate myself to go anymore, and I had really fallen asleep. And I said, I'm going to get something to eat. I'm on my way. I said, is she gone? And she said, no. No, she's not gone, but she's going. And I ate, and as I was driving on Interstate 70, I got the text again from Janet. Doug, where are you? And I knew that she was one step closer. And I drove 90 miles an hour on Interstate 70 to get to my baby. And the funny thing is that when I pulled off onto that exit in Greenville, there was somebody in front of me who didn't realize that my wife was dying. I mean, I thought the whole world knew. And so they took their time and went the speed limit, which is exactly Linda, because every time I'd go 1 mile over the speed limit, she would say, Doug, you're sinning. And I got there, and all afternoon I held her arm, and I sang, when the night seems drear, precious Lord, linger near. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, precious Lord, my guiding light, take my hand, precious Lord, and lead me home. I was talking to Sheila as I went to McDonald's for supper while her sister was still there. And Sheila caught up with me in the parking lot, and she said, Doug, you know what she's doing? She's waiting to get you alone so that you could have that last moment together. Everybody had said their goodbyes, and they had left, and they said, we'll see you tomorrow. As soon as the last person left, and I was alone in the room with her, she started to gurgle. And I began to sing, carry me, Jesus, carry me home. I've done my best, now you do the rest. Carry me home. Oh, carry me, Jesus, carry me home. I've kept the faith, I've finished my race. Carry me home. Later song this afternoon, that will make more sense to you. But as I was singing that song over and over and over and over again, my baby was being taken home. And I was being crushed. You see, for 30 years, it's been Linda and myself. And Linda would always look at me and say, "We'll make it together." I knew it was going to be different. The whole ministry here has been different. First of all, I said, "God, I'll follow you anywhere. Jesus, I'll follow you anywhere." And he led me here. And just about a week or two before that, I woke up and Jesus said, "You're going to do ministry alone." And I could easily shove that off and say that's an emotion or anything. But folks, where am I standing now? I know my Jesus. I know he speaks to me. And this morning, there's some things I want to share with you. I don't call this preaching. I just call it talking to the congregation. But there's some things I want to share with you, but I wanted you to see, no, I'm not broken. I'm crushed. If you found Isaiah chapter 64, verse 8, I just want to read that verse to you. Would you stand for the reading of God's word, please? It says this, "But now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are potter. And all we are the work of your hand." Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for this time that we gather together. Lord, and this is an occasion where we want to gather and talk about and all those things, but Lord, death is life. And Lord, I think the lesson for us is, how do we live with losing our loved one? And Lord, it only comes from leaning upon you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I always liked watching the potter and the clay. First of all, that wheel looks so much fun. And I wanted to play in the mud too. But if you watch a true master of pottery, they begin to work that wheel and they put the water to that clay and they begin to mold something so beautiful. And it's either a jar or a pot or something, a plate. And with the naked eye, we look at it and go, it is perfect. It is perfect. And so we're watching him make it, or her make it. And then all of a sudden, we see something that is so strange to our eyes. He or she looks at it, that clay pot. And he crushes it. And for those who have the eye and think it's beautiful, say, what was wrong with that pottery? Why did that potter crush that clay back down to absolutely nothing? Well, the potter knows. There was an imperfection there. There was a problem there, and if you continue working on that without crushing the clay again, it would always be that weak. He knew that he had to bring it down to rubble. You see, the master does the same thing with us. We may be feeling like we're going down the road and we've got everything in control and God is really working on us, and then we get crushed again. And we ask God, God, why do I have to go through this? Why do I have to continue in this journey? Why am I crushed? And he said, because there was an imperfection. You know, with me, and I like to be in control. Really, what I was doing in my journey was saying, Jesus, I want to be the potter, and I want you to be the clay. I woke up about 4 o'clock last, probably Thursday, and I started singing. I've been singing a lot this week. And the Lord spoke to me about 4 o'clock in the morning. He said, Doug, I'm not your genie. You can't just put me on the shelf and when you want 3 wishes, pull me down and ask me. I'm not your genie. And I have a choice in this journey, and you have a choice in this journey. You see, we can either be bitter. I can be bitter at God real easily. Why did he take my wife? I mean, we were doing so good. Or I can be better. But the better doesn't come in what has already been built. It better comes from when I'm crushed and let God do the creating again. I hear people who have lost loved ones, and I have many in my circle, say, you need to lean on Jesus. Oh, I hear the fluffy words like, I'm sorry. Jesus is near. She's in a better place. And all those things are true, but when you're hurting, they're just fluffy words. Like cotton candy in the air. I couldn't grab a hold of anything, and really what I wanted more than anything was just to have somebody come close and hold, but it was difficult. And really what I needed was Jesus to hold me more than anybody else. And so that morning at 4 o'clock, Jesus said, stop using me as a genie. I'd hear people say, you need to lean on Jesus. You need to lean on Jesus. Unless you're in this situation or a situation similar, we really don't even know what it means to lean on Jesus. I'd sing the songs, learning to lean. I'm learning to lean. I'm learning to lean on Jesus. Finding more power than I've ever dreamed. I'm learning to lean on Jesus, and not have a clue what that meant. When we lean on Jesus, it means we can't lean on anything else. I leaned on my job. I leaned on my pastorate. I leaned on my wife. I leaned on everything until I couldn't lean on those anymore. And yesterday was a breakthrough. Today wasn't so easy to get up, but yesterday was a breakthrough. And I learned what it meant to truly lean on Jesus. Matter of fact, I got excited because people say, well, you know, the Lord's going to give you a life verse that you can lean on, that you can always remember in the back of your mind. And I've been waiting for that. I mean, just something that I can grab hold of. I want to share that with you. Yesterday on the couch where Linda laid for so many months, I spoke to Jesus. And I said, Lord, I'm going through hell. And he said, I've been there. And I said, well, what did you do? I want you to get a hold of this. He said, I took the keys. You know what that means? Satan doesn't even have power in his own kingdom. Jesus is the power. Now I understand what it means by death. Where is your sting? What good is a bee or a wasp or a hornet without a sting? Why, really, it's just a fly, isn't it? It has no power. It's lost its stinger. And when Jesus said, I took the keys, he was saying, Satan can roar really loud, but he has no authority. He has no authority. I remember when I was 5 or 6 years old, and I'd get in my daddy's pickup truck, and I would sit behind the wheel and pretend that I was driving, but you know what? That pickup truck didn't have any power because it didn't have the keys. I remember standing at friends' doors, knocking on the door. They wasn't home. I had no access into the house because the doors were locked. I didn't have any power because I didn't have the keys. So when Jesus said, he's been through hell, and I said, what did you do? He didn't say, I was scared to death. I was really hot. He simply said, I went to Satan's desk and said, Satan, you have no authority. I just took your keys. So I wrote several of my friends, and I said, you know, sometime down the road, I want to get a necklace. I want a symbol of a key. And whenever I'm looking down, when I'm looking down at the grave and feeling hopeless and in despair, I'll grab a hold of that symbol and I'll remember that Jesus didn't say to look down. He simply says, look in the Master's hand. Look at the Master's hand. I have the keys. You're going through a tough time, a hard time, but Jesus is the one who has the authority. Yesterday morning before that time, I really thought, you know, what I ought to do is just go get drunk. And then it'll wipe away the pain. I know those lines. Or I should do something else to just get myself off the pain. But I'm here to tell you, folks, Jesus feels the pain too. But Jesus is the only one that we should lean on to get us through. We spend so much time. Tomorrow is Linda's funeral, and we'll look at that grave. And I know I'll put my baby in the ground. She's not there. Her spirit is in heaven already. And I gave her certain instructions when she got there too. My friend Carmen wrote me today, was talking a little bit. And she said, Doug, don't get up there and put on a show. I couldn't if I wanted to. You see, myself, I don't have the strength to stand before you. I don't have the strength to even take my next breath. But Jesus does. I stand before you because of what I want to do is be a testimony of strength of the Lord, not the strength of Doug. I'll be quite honest with you. If it was the strength of Doug, Doug would have hit that pickup truck and drove for miles and miles and miles and miles, really getting nowhere. So when you see me up here Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, because I'm not going nowhere, and when you see me walking when we meet each other on the street, I really don't want you to see me. I want people to look at me and say, now there's a man who trusts his Savior to get him through each day. I'll get stronger. I'll get through it. But this morning when I woke up, I said I didn't even want to get out from underneath the covers. I don't want to go. I didn't want to come here. I didn't want to do anything. And Janet said, today is just another glorious day. And I said, I don't want another day. I want my baby. But Jesus will get me through. And he'll get you through as well. And he holds the keys. So if you're hurting today, not just Linda, but there's so many people that goes year after year after year. And they're hurting and they're leaning upon their own understanding and their own way, and really they're becoming bitter. Don't choose bitterness. Choose Jesus. I was speaking to my sister Kathy this morning as well. I talk to a lot of people these days. She has lost her baby some years. She was about 35 years old, died of cystic fibrosis. She got her divorce from her husband. Everything was in rubbles. I told my sister this. I said, you know, kind of reminds me today, this is kind of God's thought for today. What do you do when a baby is tired and it won't go to sleep? What do you do with it? You just let it wrestle and try to fight it, don't you? Why? Because this is what you know. You'll fight and struggle and struggle and fight until it gets so tired it will fall asleep. And Jesus says this, I'll let my children fight and struggle and fight and struggle and try to do it on their own. And then when they come to the last moment and just give in, that's when I will give them peace. When we stop fighting and trying to be in control, that's when Jesus steps in. But not before. We sing songs about giving everything to Jesus. And I went to the annual meeting this year, and I listen to a lot of songs about giving everything to Jesus. I'll give everything to Jesus. You know, that's real easy to do when everything is going all right in your life. But I'm not quite sure that a lot of people even knows what it means to give everything to Jesus. And they probably fight over it if they did know what it was about. But peace doesn't come in the war. Peace comes when we surrender everything to Jesus Christ and say, Lord, I have nothing else to give you, but I give you me. And then Jesus says, peace, be still. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I pray so hard that people understand what I'm saying. Lord, I want them to see your strength and not my own. I don't have any. And Lord, I would be very comfortable just crawling in bed and not getting up in the morning and not doing things I need to do. But what would that show people about my Lord? Lord, I pray that as we step each moment of our journey, Lord, that we follow you. Even in the difficult times, in the mountaintops and the valleys, Lord, that we lean and we trust on you, Lord, because we have no strength and no power. Satan doesn't have any strength or power. It all belongs